Hi, my name is Asa Mendelson. I'm an artist and teacher and currently an MFA student at UCSD. Steffanie Ling's lecture today is part of the Visual Arts Department lecture series and will be about an hour and followed by a Q&A that will be moderated by Bailey Davenport. Before I introduce Steph, I want to acknowledge that I am sitting on this computer in unceded territory of the Kumeyaay Nation, and that part of what is now the university campus and was formerly Camp Matthews is built upon a Kumeyaay burial site. I also want to thank the Visual Arts Department staff and faculty for supporting our work, including this lecture series. Thank you to Paolo, Bailey, and Amy for making this event happen. And thank you again to Amy Adler for everything you've been doing to support us. I was really lucky to meet Steffanie Ling last year at the Flaherty Film Seminar in upstate New York. And I'm very excited for her talk and grateful that this can be a venue for it, and also wish that we were able to host her in person. Steffanie Ling is currently the artistic director at Images Festival in Toronto. Previously, she was a co-curator of events and exhibitions at Vivo Media Arts Center in Vancouver from 2017 to 2018. Her reviews and essays on contemporary art, cinema, and literature have been published in artforum.com, Brooklyn Rail, Flash Art, Hong Kong Review of Books, and Senses of Cinema, among others. Her art writing has appeared alongside exhibitions in Canada, the United States, and Europe, and have also been conducted as performances, readings at the Vancouver Art Gallery and SFU galleries, as critical responses to the works of Takashi Murakami, James Benning, and Feminist Land Art Retreat. She has conducted curatorial roles at CSA Space in Vancouver from 2014 to 2017, at 221A, also in Vancouver, 2016, residencies at MST Biennial of Performative Arts in Calgary, 2018, at Pollyanna Library in Vancouver, 2016, and BEMP Center for the Arts, 2013. She has participated in notable seminars such as Flaherty Seminar, 2019, Oberhausen Seminar, Images Research Forum in Toronto, 2018, NOPE, NOPE, Notes on Political Ecologies, Vancouver, 2016, and the Emerging Film Critics Workshop led by Kevin B. Lee, Cairo, 2015. She has led writing and criticism workshops through Stride Gallery in Calgary, 2018, and Philip, Vancouver and Los Angeles, 2018. In 2016, she worked on pamphlets published by NOPE, Notes on Political Ecologies, which was a series of pamphlets containing information gleaned from illegible or digitally archived documents on the internet detailing arrest and workers' rights. These are exclusively produced by a publicly funded artist-run center, designed to be distributed at protests and rallies, but also aesthetically blend in when dropped off at cafes, contemporary art galleries, and bookshops. Most recently, she began collaborating with the artist Casey Way to edit and publish Stills, Moving Image Tract, an experiment in correspondence criticism between Vancouver and Toronto, Canada. In 2016, she co-founded Charcuterie, a journal of experimental writing and polemics. She is also the author of NASCAR Stories, published by Blank Cheque in 2016, which weaves art writings from 2012 to 2016. Thank you so much, Steffanie, for joining us today.
Hi, thanks for the introduction. It was really sweet. I'm really grateful to see you and to be able to speak on this occasion today. I myself am situated on the unceded territories of the Musqueam, Squamish, and Tsleil-Waututh peoples, where there are currently no historic treaties. And very grateful to be a guest on this land and to be able to connect with you and be able to, share some thoughts I've been having. I should share my screen and just kind of start my lecture. Format of the oops. So I'm just gonna get my notes up here, sorry. Okay, so yeah, thank you so much to Bailey and Paolo and Asa for facilitating and supporting and inviting me to speak. I wish I could be there as well. I wasn't asked specifically to speak about anything in particular in terms of the facet of my practice or my professional experience or research, which is actually quite challenging because I know I can speak for a very long time about one thing in particular, but if I have the option to talk about anything, then I can start from a place of wanting to talk about everything, and then nothing comes. So when you start by thinking about everything, nothing is very clear, and then a couple things kind of start to emerge from the fog. So just gonna start with a clip by this talk by James Baldwin.
Words like artist or integrity or courage or nobility. I have a kind of distrust of all those words because I don't really know what those words mean. Any more than I really know what such words as democracy or peace or peace-loving, or warlike, or integration mean. And yet, one's compelled to recognize that all these imprecise words are kind of attempts made by us all to get to something which is real and which lives behind the word. Whether I like it or not, for example, and no matter what I call myself, I suppose the only word for me when the chips are down is that I am an artist. There is such a thing. There is such a thing as integrity. Some people are noble. There is such a thing as courage. The terrible thing is that all of these words, the reality behind these words, depend ultimately on what the human being, meaning every single one of us, believe to be real. The terrible thing is that all these words, the reality behind them, depend on choices one has got to make forever and ever and ever,
every day. So the first thing I asked myself from the everything fog is why curators are invited to speak to people in the first place, or invited to speak in the first place, and why do people show up and listen to them? Because I'm not entirely convinced by the social role of my profession, even though a big part of my job warrants holding an audience and being accountable to a public. So in presentations like this, I'm often asked some pretty direct and functional questions about professional development in relation to perhaps the intersection of my age and my qualifications and my accomplishments, you know, questions like, how do I get shows or build my network, or how do you access opportunities? But I think the real concerns that people have are not how did you do it or how will I do it, but I think the questions that people are really asking, not me, but themselves, and in the decisions that they make every day, are how will I pay my rent? I really think that that's the question that plagues like all fields of inquiry. And, you know, like other questions come up, like how can we philosophize about the meaning of life if you can't eat breakfast? Or perhaps it's how will I eat breakfast if I want to philosophize about the meaning of life? So I can't really answer the question about breakfast or the meaning of life, but I can offer a sort of analysis based on my experience as an institutional art worker, which is a subject position that has pretty complicated history of disruption and privilege. And so like when I started thinking about my experience as an art worker, and how to convey something useful, I had other questions like, is my job important? And like, and then like, what is my job? And then like, what do I have to say? And these are all questions that someone who is under 30 and has not been to graduate school have. So there's this like long genealogy of artists who were active organizers within social movements dating back to the Paris Commune. And in the 20th century, the moment we always return to when we examine the history of art workers in the 20th century, at least in North America, is the Art Workers Coalition in New York, which questioned the museum's relationship to labor, environmental exploitation, racial and gender disparity in public collections, and anti-war campaigns. One of the first examples of artist-driven political campaigns I encountered in my own trajectory was the Gulf Labor Coalition, which was an international and quite high-profile coalition of artists and like curators who initiated and led negotiations and provocations within the Guggenheim Museum, among the other museums that are kind of planned to be on study at the island, for their exploitation of migrant workers in the construction of the Guggenheim Abu Dhabi. And then there's WAGE, which is also led by pretty well-established critics, administrators, curators, and theorists, and et cetera. And there's also the Precarious Workers Brigade in London, whose members are not identified, however historically framed. But however historically framed, artists as professionals or art workers have exceptional potential to galvanize around causes, given that there is a basis of unity that should echo far beyond their individual practices and agendas. And like, I just wanted to note that some of the examples that I cited, they're initiatives that are led by people who have like a lot of resources. They are able to eat breakfast and they are able to contemplate the meaning of life. So that's like something that we should bear in mind because the position that I'm speaking from is as a curator, and I'm able to eat breakfast and also contemplate the meaning of life at times. But they're not like A to B, which is kind of sort of the thing that I really, think is the, one of the illusions that we have is that like we are contemplate the meaning of life and therefore we should be able to eat breakfast rather than the other way around. So as a curator, and when I say curator throughout this talk, I mean an institutional curator and not an independent curator. I've compared my profession to that of a gatekeeper, a glorified secretary, a personal assistant, a doorstopper, an arm of the institution. And it's a job that comes with different frequencies of power and subservience that comes from all directions. And that's precisely what it is though, is that it's a job. And being a curator is my job, but it's not my practice and it's not my work. The distinction between labor and work is really, really important. So in 1968, Raymond Williams, who's a Marxist critic, differentiated work from labor in his book that I frequently draw from, Keywords. So he wrote that work stands in for the general doing or making, as well as all forms of paid employment, while labor is more explicitly affiliated with the organization of employment under capitalism. I just wanted to highlight that those two distinctions between work and labor. But under neoliberalism, the structure that buttresses these definitions have dissolved and work and labor are totally conflated. So let's see here. Yeah, so what is my job? My job is in the most rudimentary sense, it's the job of spending money on behalf of cultural institutions and then reporting those expenditures and audience numbers in order to request increases to our annual operating budgets. So this is definitely in the Canadian context. I think that it's a little bit different in the States. So if expenditures are low and audience numbers are high, then I get to keep my job. And then part of my job is also to put, or another way of looking at it is that I put capital, a little bit of capital, in the hands of mostly living artists to garner visibility and amplification of their practices as a means to mint a bit more cultural currency that will hopefully garner more professional opportunities to develop or present those practices. And we already know that the artist-institution relationship is not really an economically viable one. So as a curator, I'm institutionally positioned to perpetuate competition between artists because I can contract their labor and I empower them to generate surplus value for their work and their labor. And this isn't even like really thinking about like the surplus economy of art objects themselves. So in these terms, a curator is more or less kind of like a manager who's also a stockbroker, but both artists and curators are the shares and the clients, which I think can be considered like insider trading if I'm deploying the metaphor correctly. And I think it's only insider trading if we're willing to be cognizant of it as that. So as much as I take a lot of pleasure in making my job sound nefarious, it's honestly more like artists and curators are more like two kids trading marbles in the parking lot of a bank. And they like inspect them and talk about them and hold them up to the sun and admire them. And then, you know, while we're doing this, we're waiting for our parents to come out and hand us like a $20 bill that they just withdrew from the ATM on their way out after depositing like a huge paycheck. So the next question is my job important? I understand being a curator to be a somewhat mystified creative job, and curators can begin to view their labor as what I'm going to call important work. Especially because if I do not consider my work important, then my job may cease to exist depending on the federal, provincial, or municipal government's priorities, who are bankrolling many of the institutions in Canada anyway. So important curatorial work follows the state's agenda. Therefore, a curator at a publicly funded organization is an agent of the state, I would say. And when I say the state, of course, I mean the neoliberal capitalist settler state. So a curator expresses to a certain extent and carries out this agenda of our major funder in Canada. That's the Canada Council for the Arts. And then granting bodies vary by province and municipality. So when curatorial activities or programming mention or involve topical political discourses or conduct outreach to marginalized communities or work with artists of color, these projects can be described and reported as important work and are more likely to be rewarded funding by arts councils because it reflects well in the settler state to finance socially conscious art projects. Curators are also responsible for strategizing ways to document and report the cultural importance of this work. And sometimes this involves very detailed analytics that map geographical representation and at times, and increasingly records the ethnicity of participating and exhibiting artists. So the national, racial, and gender metrics are statistics that become woven into grant narratives to prove the important work that's being done. So important work really has very little to do with art and artists, and important work belongs to the state. So, I lost my notes. All right, so the celebrated and perceived political work of executing a liberal diversity agenda set out by the settler capitalist neoliberal state is one of many false victories of postmodernism, but it's impacted artists and art workers who've struggled with integrity much longer before that. So I just wanted to just for a second listen again to a section from Baldwin's speech.
The world you first encountered when you were 15, the world which had starved you, despised you, here it comes again. This time it is bearing gifts. If phone didn't ring before, if you had a phone. Now it never stops ringing. When people saying, what do you do? They say, won't you do this? And you become, or you could become, a very important person. You find yourself in the position of a woman I don't know who sings a certain song in a certain choir. The song begins, she says, I said I wasn't going to tell nobody, but I couldn't keep it to myself. You come full circle. Full circle. Here you are again, it'll all do all over again, and you must decide all over again whether you want to be famous or whether you want to write. And the two things, in spite of all the evidence, have nothing whatever in common. What is it at the point of the artist, since I must put it this way?
So what Baldwin is describing is a social interaction or an interaction of social production that has really, again, very little to do with art. So for example, an example that I feel I encounter very often of a non-art related social reproduction scenario is like a film pertaining to a violent lived experience is likely to receive funding by the settler state that created the violence in the first place. And the film will be screened and celebrated and white liberal audiences will attend and there will be Q&As where the filmmaker will be asked to extrapolate on their experiences or their traumas. And the narrative is one that the audience is entitled to now after watching a film that sort of invites their gaze. And on occasion, the filmmaker may receive questions that challenge the authenticity of their identity if they cite European or North American canons. And so this is a scenario where I've observed from time to time between, white audiences and racialized filmmakers. And I understand that it's precipitated by the initial violence that's essentially been refined, or that initial violence that's depicted in the film that essentially has become refined by the culture industry to be this classist microaggression at a Q&A. And in return for receiving the recognition opportunity, a marginalized artist may also experience challenges to their authenticity or ties or relationships to their community from their own community as the result of recognition and success. So, yeah, the film will bear the logo of the state funding and the credits and all the promotional materials surrounding its circulation, and the screening will be reported as important work. So while you would think that the value of a curator's labor would come from having ideas, which when I say ideas, I mean politics, ideas are pretty much secondary to effectively executing one's labor or doing one's job or spending money on behalf of cultural institutions and reporting on the expenditures and audience numbers. So if fulfilling our primary responsibilities well in order to garner value for our labor, in order to compete in the market and maintain access or remain in the labor force, then it should not be considered important work. It's just regular demystified labor. Most of the time when people go to work, they have to do things they don't want to do. That's what work is. And so what begins as a worker-owned commodity, we end up selling that to the state, and then we call that important work. So people who are in control of their labor can acknowledge that the compromises lie and that they're complicit in order to earn a paycheck, which can empower them to actually strategize around those things, around things they don't want to do. And even if we can't mitigate it, they can strategize around it even if we can't mitigate it altogether through collective organizing and unionizing and things like that. So again, and confusing labor with important work is a neoliberal con, the alienation of labor through self-exploitation. and no meaningful work can really take place, or no art can take place in these conditions. So understanding what the work or labor we do doesn't carry any qualifier, and therefore doesn't exist on any hierarchy of work, but that gives us agency to determine the political parameters of our own production and invariably our exploitation and complicity too in a larger network of capital flow and power relations.
I really don't like words like artist or integrity or courage or nobility. A kind of distrust of all those words because I don't really know what those words mean. Any more than I really know what such words as democracy or peace or peace loving or warlike or integration mean.
So I just played that clip again to sort of reemphasize resistance to resistance to perpetuating or acknowledging that the certain currency of words and how they become words or concepts or ideas or even like the notion of importance. So like the important can sort of be this kind of like a catch-all way, like it can invoke all the things that we feel become very politically sort of like popular, I guess you could say, which is really cynical. But yeah, so I'm like resistant to perpetuate ideas or theories or practices of curatorial thinking, because the best curatorial praxis that I can imagine is one that conspires with artists to execute wealth redistribution, mutual aid, or political education initiatives disguised as experimental art projects. So if you're a curator and you've been invited to speak in public and it's not a Skillshare to do exactly that, then I'm not coming to your talk. But then it's actually also not that simple, because when you start, you know, circulating those discourses, it may, you know, end up being important work that risks becoming visible and qualified in the marketplace of ideas. So resisting the appraisal of one's own work means employing a certain degree of opacity, and resisting the appraisal of your work also requires a lot of privilege. And when you render illegible the work we actually find meaning, or at least parts of it, in order to protect it from the neoliberal gaze, then whatever doesn't become visible doesn't enter the marketplace, and it can continue, and it doesn't have like a shelf life that's determined by like the forecasting of importance. So what did end up emerging out of the everything fog for myself? Earlier, I had said that curating or being a curator is not my practice and it is not my work, it is my job. And according to the first of William's definitions of work, it stands in for the general doing or making. And it is what I do and what I make in the name of kinship that emerges from the fog. So kinship is what I give away to my friends and to my comrades and to my collaborators and to my community and to myself. And labor is paid. Work is not. So emotional labor, I think, is like one of those things that kind of have garnered this like currency where we understand it as like any sort of human interaction that involves work or will work. But we call it emotional labor because it's actually been borrowed from the context in which it's like emotional work that's done in certain jobs, like service jobs or like medical jobs, where people have to exercise humanity as part of their waged labor. So emotional labor that takes place between individuals is actually work that we have control and agency over to do or not do. And when we start to think about emotional labor in like monetized terms, that's kind of like the danger that I think exists with art and with the idea of important work. So emotional work is not on the market. You can't put it in a report. You can't file it. You can't stamp it. The state can't assign it any importance. So it's yours and whom you give it to. Oh. So sometimes I consent to do this work in my job, but, or this job is, again, not my work, but this means that in my job, my work is that of being interested in unimportant ideas, which makes me somewhat a liability to the institution that I work for, or any institution that I work for, because I'm interested in shapes and colors and what they're made of. What color is the color? What shape is the shape? And my feeling is that shapes and colors can tell you if rent was paid and if breakfast was consumed. And not everyone would know it. Maybe you and your kin would know, but especially, you know, who definitely not know is Mel Brooks. So I'm gonna play this very short animation that's narrated by Mel Brooks.
What the hell is this? Must be a cartoon. Shh. Must be Bite. This looks like Bite. I remember when I was a boy in Russia, it was biology. Bite. Up. Oh, it's born. Whatever it is, it's born. Look out! Too late. It's dead already. What's this? Russia! This is cute. This is cute. This is nice. What the hell is it? Oh, I know what it is. It's garbage, that's what it is. $2 I paid for a French movie, for a foreign movie, and I gotta see this junk. What is that? Looks like a bug. Yes. It's two things that they like each other. Sure, look at this box. Two things in love. Yeah, see how it got more like they'd envy the other thing so much. Could this be the sex life of two things? Sure, they can't show that on the screen. You get arrested. They have to pull the curtain.
Hey, could you shut up?
I'm 71. I got a right to be a loud lady. I'm going to die soon. What is this? Dots. Could be an eye. Could be anything. It must be some symbolism. I think it's symbolic of junk. Uh-oh, it's a cockroach. Good luck to you with your cockroach, mister. I didn't come to $2 in the movies to see cockroaches. Lips. See, even if they don't want it, they get dirty. Shh! Don't shush me, lady.
Hey, quiet, will ya?
Dite, dite, and filth. The fella that made this, he must be over 30 if they let him do this kind of thing, right? Why does he waste his time with this? A fella like that, he probably could drive a truck, do something constructive, make a shoe. Only $2. Out the window, Murray. I don't know much about psychoanalysis, but I'd say this is a dirty picture.
So, I watched this animation like every once in a while because I think it's very funny. But in the context of what I'm talking about, it's sort of this idea that like a shape and a color is something that, you know, can't be like universally known, especially by like this kind of voice. That's sort of like, what is it? What is that? You know, I need to know what that is. I didn't pay money to come here to not know what I'm looking at and like have like authority or like a sense of like, you know, belonging with it. And I think some of the most wordful works really cordon that off, like cordon belonging off from certain gazes, you know, it's certain kind of gaze, I think Mel Brooks like kind of really represents, I think. So I'm just particularly interested in shapes and colors to create a kind of like confusion among perhaps a certain class. It sort of segues into the next thing that I found in the fog, the everything fog, which is like antics. So both kinship and antics help me to strategize around self-exploitation and the sort of systemic exploitation that I'm institutionally set up to do. The invocation of antics in work is takes place in the arena of labor, but you know, the term sort of implies a kind of light disruption, I guess you could say. So here's a picture of Robespierre, very, very controversial figure in history. But I sort of wanted to think back to the initial example of the Paris Commune, because, yeah, I think that there's some funny things, there's some funny ties between the spirit of the Paris Commune and then like what happened, which was the reign of terror following the French Revolution. And yeah, it's like this messy, it's like this messiness that I think is quite, that I think is, I'm sort of at the beginning of my research of that messiness in thinking about like the art workers that were organizing then. And thinking about how bureaucracy has such a huge, huge, I guess, like, yeah, there's a kind of like tyranny of bureaucracy, the way that arts are administrated and kind of rolled out under this like guise of important work. And I'm sure Robespierre thought that the work he was doing was very, very important as well. So one example I like to think of when I'm feeling particularly cynical about the cultural economy of curatorial labor is this example from this book called The Demon of Writing by Ben Kafka, where he recalls like this clerk in the Committee of Public Safety who, following the French Revolution during the Reign of Terror, intercepted like thousands of files that were ordering executions of like enemies of the revolution on their way to the tribunal. So he saved their lives. He saved like 1,200 lives from the guillotine. And how he did that was that after work, this clerk went to the public baths and he soaked all these documents until they were like reduced to a pulp. And then he would launch them in small pellets through the window of the bathhouse and into the Seine. So it's kind of like as simple as it is bizarre. And I kind of think of that as like a bit of an antic. And yeah, I mean, you know, thinking about like the French Revolution is this kind of like also the betrayal, or not the betrayal, but like one of the, it's like an sort of parallel to the failure, like the failed, or like the not failed, but the false victories of postmodernism that I mentioned. So yeah, like there's like this extent in which his action can be considered, the extent to which his actions could be considered heroic is like really up for debate, just like Robespierre. But the actions were motivated by and seen through with the same material, or the material of the terror is manipulated and abstracted, like the reports were abstracted. So yeah, I think there's something in there about bureaucracy and antics. And antics, I have a lot less to say about, and all it really implies and can indicate is, yeah, like I kind of want to, I do things that I don't want to do sometimes in my job, and I would like to have fun from, you know, if while doing the things I don't want to do. And I guess that's kind of like an experiment within my role, or like within the work that I do that takes place in the site of labor that I'm consigned to. Because if you're not experimenting, then you're working. And if you're experimenting and you're not having fun, then you're really, really working. So really where the tensions are between like survival and execution and integrity in my job is like the collision of labor and work in the Raymond Williams sense, and then also the introduction of kinship and antics, and just sort of looking more and more to abstraction as a means to, I guess like have a discourse around where opacity lies and like is a form of antics or a form of light disruption. Because not everyone sort of has the privilege to unionize like the many examples that I sort of had at the beginning, like the example of like wage and the Gulf labor. It's like there's a ton of cultural capital that is sort of leveraged for those causes. And I just don't think that in the history, in the long history of like art workers, that like everyone has necessarily even like a basis of unity or the cultural currency to be able to organize like that. And then in the Paris Commune, I think one of the main artists that was organizing was like Courbet. I want to acknowledge that there's a lot of, there's a lot of privilege, professional and cultural currency in the history of art workers. And I think that there's gotta be like another way to do it that's still, that isn't so flashy, I guess you could say. So that's kind of, I sort of want to end it there because I think that these are mostly just like thoughts that I've been having about what it means to ask people to come and listen to me speak in a time when a lot of people don't have access to the things that they want to do, especially if they're trying to make art. I really wanted to offer something that wasn't just like professional, but also very personal, because I think this is sort of like the time for that, that thinking and that experimentation. Thanks. I guess like we can start the Q&A. Whenever.
Thank you so much, Steffanie, for that amazing talk. Thank you for coming and joining us today. We're gonna transition into the Q&A. My name is Bailey. I'm a second year MFA candidate at the UCSD, and I'm the coordinator for the lecture series, the graduate student coordinator for the lecture series. So I will be moderating the talk. So bring those questions in, anybody that's watching on YouTube. And I guess we'll jump right into it with our first question for Steffanie. With your philosophy of curation in mind, what projects are you curating at the moment? And how does your choice of pieces to include reflect your curatorial philosophy or have tension with it?
So that sounds like a multiple part question. So the first part is what projects I'm working on and what work I look for in those projects. The most recent curatorial line of thought that I've been thinking about is a program that's about snakes. Or not about snakes, but it's like it takes the form of a snake, like I'm interested in the form or the subject of a snake, I guess. Because I don't know. I'm interested in animal protagonists. I'm interested in how the snake is like affiliated with so much. It's like so demonized, and it kind of, it has like all these cultural affiliations, and I don't really know anything about snakes. So I'm looking for snake work right now. Yeah.
Excellent. Have you found any good snake work?
Yeah, I mean, I think I was thinking about actually including the badger mushroom snake video from the internet. You know the one, Bailey?
No.
It's like one of the earliest animations, I think, of like web 2.0, whatever, you know, maybe we're past 2.0, 2.1.0. I don't know that much about the internet, but it's like this, like, it's basically like a badger, a mushroom, and a snake, and there's a song, and the song just kind of like dictates or describes what comes on the screen, and the three lyrics in the song are badger, mushroom, snake. So I was kind of interested in like that, because so much of the work that we expect to see in the cinema is now on the internet. So I wanted to see what would happen if I took something that has exclusively existed on the internet and put it in the cinema. So that's kind of like the beginning of like that curatorial line of thinking. And then, you know, the artists or the work kind of like sort of gather around that. And I think that it's such a sort of strange sensibility that I think that when I do work with artists, I want to tell them like, this is why I would like to include your work. This is what I thought. This is something I saw. This is something that I thought could happen. And those conversations that take place really allow me to be really intentional about the work that I'm including in a way that doesn't sort of like follow this formula where I don't want to present an artist with an important idea and say, hey, your work fits into my important idea that I will like later report, you know, or like later describe or later utilize in order to keep my job relevant in the eyes of the state. So I think that like just having a really simple idea that is kind of rooted in something very rudimentary or simple, like a shape or a color, can just form really interesting bonds, which is also like related to kinship. So I think I've answered the question.
Awesome, thank you. Let's see. Can you speak a little about your experiences working as the artistic director of the Tkaronto Images Festival?
Yeah, I mean, I have a job at the Tkaronto Images Festival, or the Images Festival in Tkaronto. I'm really not sure how to answer that, because I think that in the talk, of course, like, it's not my job that I'm talking about. It's just like the nature of work, or my kind of work, or my line of work. So I want to make that very clear that it's not like, it's not a diatribe about my job. I quite like my job at times. I quite dislike my job at times, but that doesn't really say anything. It doesn't mean anything. So I'd like, you know, if someone wants to know something specific, I can try and answer that. But in terms of being able to speak about my job very broadly, it's how I eat breakfast.
Someone asks, you mentioned curation as a creative methodology. Where do you feel that creative outlet is able to express itself in your work?
Well, when I mentioned it in my talk, I was sort of talking about being like resistant to the idea of trafficking creative theories or cultural theories or methodologies, cultural, critical, curatorial. Like all these words are just like, you can just swap them out, you know, and they all mean the same thing, or you all end up in the same place, unless you're like getting really, really, like really like granular about it, which I'm not sure that we are. But in terms of like methodologies, it's like, I think that like the like having a methodology is almost, for me, it's like kind of like a strange curse, because then once you deploy a strategy and strategy work, you want to use the strategy again. So then when you keep using the same strategy over and over again, then you're it's like becomes like machinic or like formulaic, and then it's not interesting. And if you're not doing something that's interesting and you're inviting people to be involved in doing something that you've done before, then there aren't ideas or politics in that. So I guess like, it's a bit trite to say, but it's just sort of like a curatorial methodology is one of those, traps of like curatorial training, is that they tell you, you need to have a methodology. And when they say you need a curatorial methodology, in some senses, you know, obviously people all have methodologies and strategies that they employ cognitively and unconsciously, consciously and unconsciously. I mean, we're all doing it cognitively. And like really what they're telling you to do is to brand yourself. And you know, branding, neoliberalism, it all connects.
Yeah, for sure. It's all connected. Kalechi asks, I love the videos you curated in your talk. What was the bond that you have to color? What is the bond that you have to video sampling?
I present videos when I think they help me to say things that I think someone has said or can show better than I can, which I think has a lot to do with why I'm not an artist and I'm a curator. So it's an interesting question because it's medium specific in terms of like the curation of video. And I guess like a big part of my job is to curate videos. So maybe it's like a bit of like an unconscious bias that like I wanted to show videos, but also, you know, I also showed images. There's a lot of words in there too. And I think you kind of need a little bit of everything to keep it inviting. I also know that this talk is happening in a very static arena. So I think that I chose to deploy my talk the way that I did because I wanted it to be interesting. And I think it's a kind of like hospitality that if you're asked to speak and people come and listen and ask questions, that you should have something to offer them. So I have offered these video clips.
Let's see, Fabiola asks, can you talk more about how you are using the concept of opacity and Baldwin as a framing device? Following on Kalechi's question.
What did Fabi say about Baldwin?
She asked, can you talk more about how you are using the concept of opacity and Baldwin as a framing device?
Sure. So maybe I'll answer the second question first. I really appreciate, I listened to this talk a lot. I listened to it at least 10 times in the preparation for this presentation. And I think that it's quite interesting the way that Baldwin doesn't have any examples, you know? Like he's just speaking as a person. He's like very vulnerable in all of his speeches and deliveries. And I don't have a relationship to his, to like a lot of like oration, the way that I don't respond to a lot of oration, or at least like archived oration, the way that I do to Baldwin. And I think a lot of it does have to do with who he is, or like how he became who he is, through his style of oration. And I sort of don't want to say he's like a framing device. I want to say that he's sort of more like a friend or like a companion in putting the presentation together, and also doing it in a way that is very isolating and atomized. because I don't get to see anyone's faces. I'm not in a room with any bodies. So I think that when you have words or a voice that has been very much with you while you're trying to like accomplish something, that's something that I think maybe why I employed him or invited him to be a framing device. Anyway, I don't really like, it's kind of a creepy thing to say, call him a framing device. If I think of him as a companion, then I can't go back to thinking of him as like a framing device. And then in terms of like opacity, I think about opacity in terms of just like, you know, like in like bureaucracy, people say things like, oh, this person is on a need to know basis, you know? And that's like a very, I think it's a very like, it's kind of like a military sentiment. It's like very like I'm interested in notions of leadership politically, but in an artistic realm, I think that it is counter to collective thinking and sharing and vulnerability that I think is important in my own work. And work is like definitely the word that I'm using. So I sort of wanted to think about opacity in art as like a way of saying like, there's certain things that white audiences don't need to know. They're on a need to know basis. And the need to know basis is that they don't need to ever know like certain visual languages or certain subjects or certain like references that are employed in the film that they are like, they get as shapes and colors and they appreciate them as shapes and colors and that's it. And that's all they get. So that's kind of how I think about opacity. But it's interesting maybe perhaps in relation to Baldwin, because Baldwin was somebody who spoke about the need for, especially particularly in his writing about film, he talks about how it's really important for Black people to be seen buying things, drinking beer, brushing their teeth. So he's kind of like more so spoken and written about representation, which is a kind of transparency. But he's advocating for that in a sense of like, in the sense of like safety, even though in other talks he's talked about how like safety doesn't exist or it's a total like illusion. So yeah, like when he talks about, when he doesn't talk about opacity, he's talking about survival. And then I think about opacity, I think about survival in like a sort of more like pedagogical sense or like a more like sort of like culturally specific sense. And it's like specific to the context of art and not in this like much broader, and, you know, it leaks, art leaks, but it's not like, and I would never like think about my thinking to Baldwin as closely as I feel like I am in this answer. So yeah, I just want to be clear that bringing those things together is in the context of that, of the question, but it's not something that I'm like super, super, feel super confident like aligning.
Let's see. Sindhu asks, do you think that part of curatorial work is temporal to allow artists and audiences more time to do, quote, other things?
Other things. Did she say other things?
Yeah.
Like other things. Other things. Like, I wish I could ask her what she meant by other things. Well, yes. So the question is, do I think of it as temporal?
Yes. Do you think that part of curatorial work is temporal? I assume in order to allow artists and audiences more time to do other things rather than curate their own work, I suppose.
That's a really interesting question. How much time do we have?
We still have a few minutes left for the Q&A.
I really wish I had a short answer to that question, but I don't, because I think the notion of like other things, if the question of other things is so that like curators can liberate artists' time so they don't have to facilitate the presentation and discourse of their own work, that's really interesting, because I encounter a sensibility where artists would prefer not to have curators do that work for them. You know, like they would like to very much like very empowered workers. Like they want to have the agency to do, to like, yeah, like to self-manage in a strange way. And like the Art Workers Coalition actually, and also the artists who were organizing during the Paris Commune would argue for things like control over museums. So I think that's like a really interesting sentiment, because I think it's sort of is more grounded in the very traditional sense of curating as like caretaking. Because I think there's like some Boris Groys essay that talks about how like the root word of curating is to care or something like that. And it's like, yeah, I do care. I care a lot. I just like don't like want to care in the way that the state wants me to care. I think it's more important for artists and curators to have very frank conversations about the expectations of caring, you know, or like the expectations of like how much to extend, how much to withhold, how do I care for this person? Maybe not caring is a way to care for this person. You know, maybe I have to send this person to another person to care for them differently. So yeah, I think that like, in that sense, like I wonder if that question comes from a place where there's like a lot of like, there's more of like this relationship to the institution to do advocacy, which is super valid as well. So.
Okay, awesome. Maybe one last question and then we'll break for the evening. Asa asks, maybe related question, thinking about what you said towards the end of your talk about desiring less flashy modes of art programming. Do those less flashy modes necessarily take place off the clock?
I think that the last thing, in terms of like things not being flashy, I was just thinking about, I was trying to think about some of the sort of more successful or like broadly recognized initiatives or campaigns that have been led by artists within the history of like art working or art workers organizing that I sort of like very in a very cursory way charted. And I thought to myself, like, these projects are led by people who have a lot of resources. Like they make like a lot of money basically, or like they, or maybe they don't make a lot of money, but they belong to institutions and they fly around the world. So, you know, that's an optic. And I'm looking at it. So when I think about something that's less flashy, I'm thinking about like more so in the realm of like these antics that take place between like artists and curators, or artists and artists, or curators and curators, or just between art workers in general. When they don't have the resources to launch like really, really elaborate campaigns that like, you know, rally people behind like artists' living wage, which are really important, and the people who have resources should be doing that, and they are, or some of them are. But if you don't have that, then like the less flashy thing is exercising opacity. So does that answer the question?
Yeah, I think so.
Okay.
I think, oh, there's one more question from Fabiola. If you don't mind answering one last question, you mentioned our needing to get more personal right now. I'm guessing this is in relation to pandemic, but can you talk about ways you anticipate you'll engage that way?
Sure. So I think that I think it's important for me to say that like in the sight of my labor, I think that the personal approach can transgress a lot of boundaries in terms of how labor is organized. So like I do subscribe to quite a bit of hierarchy and understand protocol and like policies and things like this. And that helps, that actually like when it's really robust, it actually protects me, you know? And then when I talk about getting personal in a time like this, it's because like, we're actually, we're just way farther away from stuff like that than we have been, because there's no precedent for anything that, for a lot of the things that we're experiencing or a lot of the routine that we're trying to establish. And like, I guess in terms of like strategies for personal approaches is that like maybe like I could talk a little bit about my work at Images, which was that like I started to give like quite long land acknowledgements before screenings would start. And when you start to, and I think the reason why land acknowledgements are kept short is to narrow the opportunity for a settler to say something stupid or to make a mistake or to learn or like to exhibit learning. So in these land acknowledgements I would give, I would try to demonstrate that I was trying to learn something and that there were things that I didn't know. And people who were watching the programming or tuning into the programming, like hundreds of people would see me not knowing things. And I think that like, because I wasn't with hundreds of people and I was just by myself, it actually made it easier. But I think that it was like this image projecting of like somebody who actually has a lot of time, or like now that we all kind of collectively have different, or we have a lot of time in a different way, or it like falls very differently, that like political education is a priority for me. And conducting political education can sometimes be a personal act. It can mean being more respectful to somebody that you weren't previously, or that you had wanted to be, but you like didn't have the capacity to learn how, in a very personal realm. But also like that's kind of also like this like an analogy for like the relationship between like a settler identity and like the land that they live on, for example. So I think that's one example of like a personal approach to the context that we're living in and in the work that I do. So
awesome. Thank you so much for taking the time to come and talk with us today over Zoom. It was really great having you. And
thank you.
And thanks to Paolo also for helping us as always with the technical stuff. And thank you, Amy, and the visual arts department. So thanks everyone.
Thank you. Bye.